who, I mean, we lead in resources, but mm-hmm. not a lot of people know. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I come across new resources all the time.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wow, I didn't know that this exists.
Mm-hmm.
So this way, now that we know, we have identified it.
Right.
And we have to push it out to people to say, yeah. hey, you know, there's another well that you can drink from.
Exactly.
You know, these are the services. Go out there and,
yeah.
and, you know, take advantage of these services.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know that, because I know a lot of people talked about, oh, wow, you know, you come back from the military. What do you do now? But there are resources out there for people to go to.
They are. I mean, there are growing resources, but at the same time, the key thing is, you know, identification and linkage to these resources. And I think the more people are aware of, you know, what's there, then the better there will be, you know, mm-hmm. and try and obtain these services.
Now, the other question that I was going to ask you, which kind of answered already from the previous questions,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's how the Army helping you and your family, which you talked about a little bit earlier, but maybe a little bit more how your family get help from it.
Well, in terms of, you know, personally for myself, I looked at it as, you know, as I mentioned to you before, the educational
mm-hmm.
benefits. I mean, we know that education
right.
paves the way for the future.
Right.
So, I mean, the key thing with the Guard, but providing, you know, free state
mm-hmm.
Tuition,
oh, yeah.
of course,
yeah.
That, you know, softens, you know, the blow mm-hmm. on your wallet, you know, to a great extent. So this way, you know, you're able to, you know, have, you know, that refined knowledge,
mm-hmm.
you know, and maybe, you know, 2-3 years down the line, maybe 4 years down the line, you may decide
mm-hmm.
that the military, you know, is no longer for you.
Right.
You know, you've done your time. But when you leave, at least you have that opportunity to say, okay, I have a degree.
Right.
You know, I'm able to, you know,
do something else. That's great.
So, and personally for me, that's one of the ways and advantages that, you know, I was able to take advantage of.
That's great.
You know, and, you know, it's a great advantage.
That's excellent. Now, to join the Army, do you have to be a U.S. citizen, or it doesn't matter? Do you, from any other countries, or how does that work?
Well, no. If you're a permanent resident, you can
okay.
actually join the Army or any of the branches too, as well.
Okay.
Now, keep in mind that depending on the nature of what you do
mm-hmm.
in the military,
mm-hmm.
Then the requirements may change,
mm-hmm.
where you would have to become a naturalized citizen.
Okay.
So, but in generally speaking, you don't have to be, you know, a citizen to join.
Wow.
But, you know, later down the road,
you do.
Then, you know, they like I said, depending on the nature of the job that you do.
You have to travel.
Well, you have to travel. Plus, also, the key thing is it's about, you know, the nature of the security of things that are happening
okay.
out there. Because you will have to go through a background investigation.
Okay.
Like I said before, it all depends on, you know, which particular specific type of responsibilities and duties that you have.
Wow, so you don't have to be a U.S. citizen to, I've heard you had to be a U.S., but that's very good. Thank you for clarifying that for us. It's excellent. Now, how the other opportunities for employees in the Army? Are there employees, like employment opportunities?
Well, there's a lot of employment opportunities. It all depends on what you're looking to do,
mm-hmm.
and that's the key thing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the military, you know, is a, you know, a great, you know, a channel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a vehicle. It actually can provide you, you know, that entry level skill that
mm-hmm.
you need.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you want to make the military a career, or maybe you may choose to go out there in the workforce. But it all depends on what you want to do, and sky's the limit. I mean, it supports you in any way possible, but it all depends on, you know, your desire.
What you choose to do,
and your choice of what you want to do, correct.
That's some good information for the viewers to know all that.
Oh, no, of course. It's, like I said, the information is key. It's just understanding, you know, how to go about getting it.
So, Jacques, where are the National Guards located?
Well, we have armories located throughout the state. And one of the unique natures of the National Guard is most of the armories are within the communities, and they could be very well near your house. And for the most kids, you probably wouldn't realize or know. But they are scattered throughout the state. And pretty much, you know, some of them are more regional. But
mm-hmm.
for the most case, you know, I would say around each town, or each few towns. But I think that it's more regionally based
mm-hmm.
In the surrounding neighborhoods.
Excellent. Now, do you know how many are there in Massachusetts?
Well, not exactly. I know that there's a lot of Massachusetts.
I'm sure there is.
The actual number escapes me.
That's great. Now, where can soldiers find information?
Well, the key number, the key resource I always link service members to is the Military One Source.
Oh, yes.
Because
we did talk about that.
You know, there's so many, abundance of services. Mm-hmm. But if you go and you access the Military One Source site, mm-hmm. then you can obtain, you know, pretty much anything you need mm-hmm. As it relates to service members and their families.
Oh, that is the key word. One service. I'm trying to remember it.
Military One Source.
Military One Source.
Yes.
You hear me, folks? We'd like you to remember that. One Military Source. And you can all find all the information you need. Next one. What resources are available for survivors? I know we talked about that earlier.
Yes, briefly. The deployment cycle support program. Mm-hmm. We have a survivors outreach program, mm-hmm. and that program is directed toward families of the fallen service members. Mm-hmm. So the key thing to understand in that program mm-hmm. is, you know, we have a team that goes out there and does casualty notification when something has taken place. But if the service member were to fall, the SOS or Survivor mm-hmm. Outreach Services would mm-hmm. actually be in place to assist the family members, mm-hmm. You know, for a longer duration of time through their hardship.
Wow, that's excellent. Now, tell me a little bit about your orphanage program.
Yes, indeed. We have an orphanage that we run with about 175 children. Mm-hmm. And that orphanage is Bombeje Orphanage. And that's in an area called Seca Cavajal.
Yeah, that's in Haiti.
Indeed. And the beauty of the program, of the orphanage, is that we provide the educational and we provide the medical mm-hmm. support mm-hmm. And assistance that the children need there as well. So the children do come and stay, and the schooling is done right next door. We just completed a renovation mm-hmm. of the orphanage, so we're going to have a grand reopening mm-hmm. This fall.
Mm-hmm. It's devastating with the earthquake, and then Haiti was already in a bad shape. Now it's even 10 times worse.
Well,
we need the help.
Exactly. You know, and what happens is, you know, as this earth or aftermath of this earthquake prolongs, mm-hmm. Then of course, you know, getting back, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. To normalcy, you know, mm-hmm. it gets mm-hmm. much more difficult because mm-hmm. you're not dealing with a country, you know, that had a strong foundation in terms of services.
Oh, yeah.
You're dealing with a country that's, you know, labeled impoverished, but for so many reasons, you know, the key thing is trying to, mm-hmm. you know, help the families get what they need. Mm-hmm. But those resources, which must be sustainable in order for them to overcome this plight.
Yeah, you need a strong team. Yes, absolutely. I know we will be showing some photos in the slideshow
of
Haiti later on in the show. And also we have an annual fundraising event. Jacques can talk to us about a little bit about that.
Yes, we have an annual fundraising event that's scheduled the 28th of May in Randolph. That's a 25 tea drive at the Knight of Columbus. At the fundraising event, you know, there's a lot of literature, a lot of presentations. We try to keep it specific in nature to what, you know, we're doing. Mm-hmm. It's almost like reporting back. Mm-hmm. One of the key things is when a person makes mm-hmm. a donation to the organization or mm-hmm. any organization, mm-hmm. you know, there must be a sense of transparency and accountability mm-hmm. For the person to understand that dollar that you gave, mm-hmm. you know, this is what it's doing mm-hmm. and this is the impact that it's making. Mm-hmm. So this way you can have, you know, that sense to, you know, re-donate or to the organization again to understand that your money is going toward, you know, a fruitful endeavor. Exactly.
And the donors always need to know that information in order to donate again.
Exactly.
So you don't want to have
They must always know that piece of
it. You feel comfortable.
Yes. Definitely. I mean, with the economic situation happening right now, the person or donor, you know, must be made aware and ensure that, their money being applied at the right place to do the right thing.
Absolutely.
And, of course, people want to know more information about it, they can access the website at www.osdpc.org for more information about ongoing initiatives and also the annual fundraiser, too, as well.
Excellent. Are there any fundraising, other event going on right now at this moment before May, or is it you're working on?
This is what we're working on right now as it relates to the fundraising. There's a lot of small scale things that we do within the community too as well, but as it relates to the fundraising, the key one is the one on the 20th of May.
Excellent. Now, anything else you'd like to share with the youth that are interested in being in the military? Any thoughts that you like to leave my viewers with?
Sure. I mean, the key thing is the key thing is to being able to see what you're interested in. How you want to contribute. If you want to be part of a bigger organization, an organization that's bigger than yourself, whether it be any of the branches, it doesn't matter. The key thing is, to show your patriotism. And if it's through the armed forces, then it's a great place to go. It's a great organization to be part of, and it's changed my life. It changed the life of my family, and one of the many ways, or one of the most important ways, it changed me. Other than the fact that we talked about education, was right after the earthquake. There was a massive military support that was sent to Haiti, and one of the units that were going, I actually was able to, through another position assignment that I had in the military, link with the commander of that unit, and was able to actually be part of the rescuing mission. So we have another partner that we have Road to Development that we had exactly. And what we did was we brought people from the outskirts. A lot of calls were made. Now keep in mind that there was an issue with communication right after the earthquake. A lot of people use Skype.
So
this way we're able to the texting was a key thing.
That was great.
So this way what happened was we got all these people together and we were able to find the coordinates or the locations of where people were trapped. And while they were on the ground reporting, this person was trapped here, this person was trapped there, they would send it back to us here in the state, and we would take that information and send it over to the rescue teams through the military. And in this way, they were able to rescue a lot of the survivors on the ground.
Yeah, technology.
Exactly.
Thank God for technology.
No, thank God for technology.
thank God for you. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you
so much for all your great help in Haiti and other endeavors, other states, other countries.
Yes, but the key thing is, as I mentioned before, being able to, fall back in the community and knowing that, there is a support network and, the whole essence of being able to give back, and that's a way to give back. Whether it be volunteering for the organization or volunteering to do something good, the spirit of giving, is one of the greatest, contribution,
of mankind. Good movement.
Exactly.
Well, thank you so much for being on the show.
No, thank you.
Thank you.